Now in this section we have to study about another O-type tube like klystron, that is a traveling wave tube. Traveling wave tube is a form of thermionic valve or tube which is used for high power microwave amplifier designs. So it is capable of producing and amplifying microwaves of higher power when compared to that of the klystron. Also it is a O-type tube when compared to that of the N-type magnetron device. The traveling wave tube can be used for wideband RF amplifier design. Even now it performs well against devices using newer technology. That is, even though semiconductor technology is being advancing, traveling wave tubes are still used for generation and amplification of microwaves. That is, it is capable of producing high power microwaves. So it finds many applications including broadcasting, radar, satellite transponders, etc. Even though klystron and traveling wave tube both are O-type or original type tubes in which the electric field and magnetic field are in step with each other, there are large differences between these two type of amplifiers. The first difference is klystron is a narrow band device whereas traveling wave tube is a broad band device. That is, it can be used for generation of powers which are in the more wider ranges. The microwave circuit is non-resonant in traveling wave tube while resonant circuits are used in klystrons. That is, we know in case of klystron we have got many resonant cavities, but in traveling wave tubes we do not have such resonant structure. In case of klystron, the interaction of electron beam and RF field is going to occur only in the cavity grids, only for very few gaps of resonant cavities. But in case of traveling wave tubes, the interaction between electron beam and RF field is continuous over the entire length of the circuit. That is, traveling wave tube is a tube type in which the interaction between the electrons and the RF field take place continuously over the entire length of a tube. Another difference is the wave in the traveling wave tube is a propagating wave, whereas the wave in the klystron is not propagating. That is, RF field is taken as stationary in case of klystron. Only the electron beam is traveling and the RF field is stationary. But this is not the case with traveling wave tube. Both the RF field and the electrons will be traveling and they will be interacting over the whole length of the tube. Another difference, in coupled cavity traveling wave tube, there is coupling effect between the cavities, whereas each cavity in the klystron is going to operate independently. So even though both are O-type tubes, these are the stated differences between the two type of tubes. Now this is the cutaway view of a traveling wave tube. So these are the components in a traveling wave tube. First one is the electron gun, obviously for producing and accelerating electrons for whole the length of the tube. Then two RF input we are providing, and obviously we should be having 6 is the RF output, 7 indicates the vacuum tube, and again we will be having magnets. These magnets are for focusing of the electron beam into the tube. Then again we'll be having a placement of attenuator at the center point of the tube. Then a helix or a slow wave structure is placed at the tube. And again, we'll be having a point to collect the RF output or our amplified output. And similar to the klystron, again, we'll be having a collector to collect the electrons which are emerging out from this slow wave structure. So what is the need of the magnet? What is the need of attenuator? What is the need of helix coil? All will be explained in the subsequent sections. Now, this is a detailed diagram for a helix traveling wave tube, where all the supply voltages are also shown in the diagram. Heater supply, regulated beam supply, collector supply, etc. The working of this helix traveling wave tube could be explained by a simplified diagram as shown in the next slide. Now about the working operation of traveling wave tube, it is explained by using the simplified figure. That is, first and foremost, it consists of an electron gun. The electron gun section is consisting of a heated cathode which is used for the emission of electron. Obviously, these electrons will be focused by using this anode on the length of the tube. Now, this RF field, that is RF input which we are providing, and the electron beam are to interact over the whole length of the tube, unlike that in klystron. Now here the electron beam is focused by a constant magnetic field along the electron beam and slow wave structure. This is termed as a O-type tube or a original type tube. These slow wave structures are placed in order to prolong the interaction between these electron beam and the RF input. That is, usually the RF wave will propagate with the velocity of light, that is c, and the electron beam will travel with a velocity which will depend upon the voltage which is provided. Now in order to make both the velocity almost equal so that it will interact over the whole length of the tube, slow wave structures are placed so that it will reduce the velocity of the RF. So prolonged interaction takes place and finally we get an amplified output. So RF output is the output which we are collecting, that is the amplified version of the input which we have provided here. And finally the emerging electrons can be collected here by means of a collector. Now we are going to explain the significance of each and every part in a traveling wave tube. First of all, we have got a electron beam focusing magnet which is placed along the tube. This surrounding static magnet is to prevent the spreading of electrons as it travel along the tube. That is, focusing is done of the electrons into a tight beam once it enters the tube. And as it travels along the tube, it should not get spreaded. That is why we are using a magnet to focus the electron beam. Another important thing, we have got a slow wave structure, that is a helical structure, is placed at the center of the tube for providing a low impedance transmission line for RF energy within the tube. So we have to ensure maximum interaction of the electron beam with the RF energy. For that only we are placing this helix slow wave structure at the center of the traveling wave tube. So mainly the helix delay structure is to reduce the velocity of the RF wave so that RF waves and electrons interact maximum. Okay, so it is used to slow the traveling wave down to or below the speed to the electrons in the beam. Usually the RF signal is going to propagate inside a waveguide with the velocity of light. But when we are placing a helix wire, it will travel with a lesser speed than the velocity of the light. That is, we are having a coiled shape, helical shape inside the tube, so that it is forced to travel a greater distance than the electron beam. So that we are going to ensure that over whole the length of the tube, the interaction takes place so that we get a more amplified output. Now we have a helical structure inside the traveling wave tube, which is going to produce an axial electric field in the traveling wave tube. By adjusting the number of turns or the diameter of the turns in the helix wire, we could adjust the speed at which the RF signal wave travel in the form of axial electric field. Always we take care that the DC beam velocity of the beam is maintained slightly greater than that of the axial field. Then only amplification of the signal can occur. This is further explained in the subsequent section. The helical delay structure has the added advantage of causing large proportion of electric field that are parallel to the electron beam. So we know that electron beams are propagating. In addition, the helical delay structure is also going to produce an axial electric field which is going to interact with the electron beam along the whole length of the tube. So maximum amplification takes place by means of bunching. So the moving electrons will interact with the RF field and form the bunching process. Now we have the significance of placement of attenuator. The attenuator is placed midway on the helical structure. It is to attenuate any reflected waves generated due to impedance mismatch. That is, it will reduce all the waves which are traveling on the helix nearly to zero, so that it will prevent any waves which are coming from the output side to the input and thus prevents any type of mismatch or oscillations in the input circuit. Now it is placed almost along midway, okay, after sufficient length of the interaction region, so that the attenuation of the amplified signal is insignificant compared to the amplification. That is, electrons, bunched electrons which are coming out of the attenuator, they are going to induce a new electric field in the helical structure, which further does the amplification process. So it is placed after sufficient length of the interaction region, that is almost midway after one helical structure, so that the attenuation cost of the amplified signal is very much insignificant compared to the amplification finally produced. Now what will happen inside the tube, or how is the interaction going to occur between the electron beam and the RF wave is explained here. We are going to apply our input signal around the turn of the helix. So obviously we will be getting a production of an axial electric field at the center of the helix directed along the helix axis. And this axial electric field, we can see that it is going to progress with a velocity which is not equal to of light. If helix structure was absent, it would have propagated with a velocity of light c. But since a helical wave structure is present, it is going to travel with a velocity equal to velocity of light multiplied by the ratio of helix pitch to the helix circumference. When the electrons are going to enter the helix tube, an interaction takes place between the moving axial electric field and moving electrons. These moving electrons are the electrons which are coming from the heated cathode. And this moving axial electric field is the electric field which is produced due to the RF input in the helical structure. So on the average, after the interaction between the moving electrons and axial electric field, the electrons will transfer the energy to the wave on the helix. So thus amplification is going to take place. The interaction causes a signal wave on the helix to become larger. So this amplified version only, we are collecting it as output. Now this slide explains in short how the velocity modulation and amplification process is occurring in a traveling wave tube. We know that we are going to supply the RF input on the helical structure. Those electrons which are entering the helix at zero field, they are not subjected to any velocity modulation. That is, they travel further on with unchanged velocity. And those electrons which are entering the helix at accelerating field will be accelerated, and those entering the helix at retarding field will be decelerated. So obviously there is velocity modulation taking place, and as the electrons travel further along the helix, they begin to form bunching. So these bunching will be centered about those electrons with unchanged velocity, that is, they enter the helix during the zero field and are collected at the collector end. The bunching is going to shift the phase by pi by 2. Now always we maintain the DC voltage to be very high. The DC velocity of the electrons is going to be high than the axial wave velocity, that is the velocity of the electrons which are traveling in the helical structure. More electrons will encounter the retarding field than the accelerating field. So the electrons will be forced to transfer the energy from the electron beam to the electromagnetic field. Thus way the amplification of the signal is accomplished. So we can collect the amplified output from the helical structure. The bunch becomes more compact and larger amplification of the signal voltage is going to occur at the end of the helix. So we get an amplified version of the signal when compared to the input which we have applied, and always the energy is transferred from the electrons, from the moving electrons to the field, and for this the DC velocity of the electrons are kept greater than the axial wave velocity, so that electrons will encounter more retarding phase than the accelerating phase. The velocity modulation process is explained here. That is, the electrons which is going to enter the helix at zero field, they are unaffected by the signal wave, and those entering the helix at accelerating field are subjected to acceleration, and those at the retarding field are decelerated. So the electrons will be forming bunches, that is, they are going to travel with different velocities. So it causes bunching of electrons at regular intervals of one wavelength. Now, as the bunch release energy to the signal on the helix, amplification begins. That is due to the interaction, prolonged interaction between the electron beam and the RF wave. The electrons in the retarding phase will transfer their energy to the RF wave. We get an amplified signal. And this amplified signal causes a denser electron bunch, which in turn amplifies the signal even more. This process continues as the RF wave and the electron wave travel along the length of the tube. When the loss in the system is compensated by the energy transfer, a steady amplification of the microwave signal appears at the output end. That is, even though we are placing an attenuator at the middle of the helical structure, this attenuation is negligible when you are comparing to the amplification produced in the tube. Now, the beam velocity is maintained greater than the field velocity. That is, the axial field in the helical wave structure is always less than the DC beam velocity. Then only the electrons are going to face more the retarding field than the accelerating field, so that greater amount of kinetic energy will be transferred from the electron beam to the electromagnetic field. Thus, the field amplitude increases, forming a more compact bunch, and larger amplification of the signal voltage is going to appear at the output of the helix. Now, here are stated some characteristics of traveling wave tube. Traveling wave tube is a high gain, low noise, wide bandwidth microwave amplifier. Compared to that of the klystron, it is having a higher bandwidth and it is capable of gain greater than 40 dB with bandwidth exceeding an octave. Traveling wave tube have been designed for frequencies ranging from 300 MHz to high 50 GHz. So basically it find application as a voltage amplifier. There is a wide bandwidth and low noise characteristic make the TWT ideal for use as a RF amplifier in microwave equipment. And also they can develop power up to 2.5 kilowatt, and it can also find application as a coupled cavity traveling wave tube, which can deliver power level up to 15 kilowatt. The efficiency of traveling wave tube is stated from 20% to 40%. So these are the few characteristics of a traveling wave tube.